November is a season for remembering, and in this service, we especially remember our founders and all those whose generosity through the centuries has enabled this college to grow and flourish.
Let us now sing the praises of famous men and women, our ancestors in their generations. The Lord appointed to them great glory, his majesty from the beginning. There were those who ruled in their kingdoms and made a name for themselves by their valour, those who gave counsel because they were intelligent, those who spoke in prophetic oracles, those who led the people by their counsels and by their knowledge of the people's law. They were wise in their words of instruction. All these were honoured in their generations and were the pride of their times. Some of them have left behind a name so that others declared their praise. But of others, there is no memory. They have perished as though they had never existed. They have become as though they had never been born, they and their children after them. But these also were godly men and women, whose righteous deeds have not been forgotten. The assembly declares their wisdom, and the congregation proclaims their praise.
In Alexandria, the city where there was such iniquity, lived a young maiden who was most noble and fair. This damsel was 18 years old. Her name was Catharine. Her father, while he was alive, was king. He had no other children but Catharine. He made sure that she learned from scripture and that she learned how to debate with others and defend her point of view. There was not a dialectician in the world who could overcome her on any subject. She was wise about worldly matters, but her desire was to understand higher things. She dedicated her whole purpose, value, and fair youth to God. One day she was resting in the city about which I spoke earlier, when she heard a great noise of destruction and was most afraid. So, with her attendants, she came to the temple. There she saw Christians weeping, lamenting, groaning, and suffering, terrified of their impending deaths, having seen the others sacrificed. When she heard the noise and suffering, her heart was seized with great anguish. She bent her beautiful head a little and tried to hearken to the voice of God. Her courage was mixed with great suffering, but she remained tranquil and wise. This young woman, beloved of God, thought to herself that she could make the king see reason. She wanted, with rational words, to show him that he and those who followed his rules were damned. She trusted in God and her own intelligence and fearlessly entered the temple. There she saw the tyrant sitting on high, clearly visible to all. Making the sign of the cross with her hand, she went straight towards the tyrant. She was very experienced in the art of eloquence, and so she began to state her case.
Thank you. Emperor, your dignity requires that you be saved. Worship God, who can condemn or redeem you. Love him alone and serve with your heart he who caused your birth and will bring about your death. If you had any reason, you would worship nothing but him. Fair maiden, said the Emperor, you have such a pretty face, your eyes are so lovely, and always have a wise smile in them. No mortal woman can be compared to your beauty. A royal purple robe would really suit that lovely body. Just think of your youth and follow the correct path with us. Sweet friend, leave your beliefs, for you should fear our God's vengeance, such is the harm you do them. Just trust in what I tell you, and sacrifice to our gods. You can be assured of great honour. He finished his speech. The lady heard him and smiled. She answered him in a courtly way with an accomplished little joke. Oh, how fortunate I will be when I have been fashioned out of gold. I'll have a statue named after me and everyone will worship me humbly. I'll be cast in purest gold and adored like a goddess. I wouldn't mind if it were made of silver or a less costly metal. No, really, that wouldn't be that bad, since whatever I was made of, I'd be honoured greatly. Oh, what a great honour that will be, when praise like this is heaped upon me. There is Catherine, who abandoned her God and her faith. Your Majesty, I do not care for this honour, for this praise is actually condemnation.
We'll tell you as much as we know about how the wheels worked. There were four of them, and they were large and wide. They were fashioned in such a way that sharp nails stuck out from the rims, both forwards and backwards. Two of the wheels turned one way, the other two turned the other. Where the wheels met, nothing was safe, for nails met blades, and the blades cut into the nails. There was no harsher thing on earth. Anything meeting it would soon be decimated and cut into tiny pieces. The tyrant was delighted by this and commanded that the wheels be brought before him so that he could make a sacrifice swiftly to the gods. The soldiers brought the great wheels before Catherine, displaying them to her, but she wasn't intimidated at all, either by threat or torture. She prayed to the source of all succour for consolation for all pain. When the lady had finished her speech, an angel descended from heaven. The angel started to turn the wheels, none remained intact. It spun them so fast that they could not stay together.
Thank you.
The story of St Catharine, like many stories of the saints, may contain elements of fact, but its worth is more about the meaning that it holds, the inspiration that it offers, and the values to which it encourages us to aspire. Whether or not St Catharine lived and died in precisely the way that her story relates is less important than the truths that the story contains, and how the story has shaped the people and institutions that look to her as their patron. Catherine's story is one of wisdom, courage, and integrity. Perhaps that is our story too. The commemoration text is also a story that tells a particular history of St Catharine's College. And while we have learned to read our own stories critically, the text we hear each year on St Catharine's Day remains an important narrative and an important testimony to the generosity of those who, in generations past, have believed that this college matters and has something worthwhile to offer to the world. The current community is, of course, very much part of that ongoing story. We create narratives of ourselves all the time, and our communities have narratives too. We sift through facts and experiences to find patterns of truth that enable us to make sense of how we came to be who we are. As we look for the patterns in the ordinary and extraordinary events of which our lives are made, we are also looking for the foundational values and motivations that help give our lives and the lives of our communities meaning. This is what enables us to ask not only what should we do, but more profoundly, how do we discern what we should do? What is shaping our decisions? 2020 has proved to be a particularly complex and challenging year. Being in the midst of a huge story that is still emerging, especially one that is so difficult, can be baffling and painful. We might be reminded of that scene in The Lord of the Rings where Sam says to Frodo, "It's like being in one of the old stories, and the heroes had no idea that they were in a story and how it would work out." It's only with distance that we can discern the patterns and meaning and become our own narrators. Putting things into words and speaking them can also be hard and painful, but almost always helpful too. And listening to and honouring the stories of others, even if we find them challenging or difficult or boring, is as important as articulating or sharing our own. Telling and hearing stories builds community through time, even if we are currently having to gather through the glow of the screen rather than the warmth of the campfire or the welcome of candlelight in chapel or in hall. In the summer, we recorded a song for our graduating students which began, "In years to come they'll ask us for our story, and we will tell of laughter and of tears. All our endeavours, all that brought us glory, our hopes and dreams, our failures and our fears." The song was an invitation to reflect on complex experiences with honesty, teasing out the narratives that will help us make sense of what has shaped us, what we have learned, and crucially, what gifts we will be taking with us to the wider world. May the words and music we hear in this service interweave in some way with our own emerging stories. And may there be something here that will help us to live well in the present and to build a hopeful future.
Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honourable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learnt and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you.
We have come together in the presence of Almighty God to give thanks for all those who have gone before us in this place, and in particular for the generosity and vision of those known to us by name or unknown, who by the sharing of their abilities, their talents and their possessions have established and built up this college as a community of education, learning and research. We are in duty bound to remember our founder, Robert Woodlark, sometime Provost of King's College, Chancellor of the University and Doctor of Divinity, who purchased the four tenements in Milne Street on which the college originally stood, and in 1473 dedicated this foundation to the honour of St Catharine, Virgin and Martyr, and obtained from King Edward IV a charter for the incorporation of the same. In the founder's statutes, it is enjoined that we remember King Henry VI, the founder's patron in King's College, Richard and Joan Woodlark, his parents, Lady Elizabeth de Burgh, benefactress, Thomas Lord Lawar, benefactor, Lady Joan Barnardiston, who gave 100 marks towards the first buildings, William Coote and Clement Denston, whose executors contributed £40 to complete the chapel and library. Among those who augmented the foundation in its first 50 years by providing fellowships, scholarships and other benefactions were Isabel Canterbury, the founder's sister, who gave a tenement, 1479, William Bassett, Master of God's House, who gave the tabard in Babraham to found a fellowship, 1487, Richard Nelson, Fellow of Mickle House, who founded a fellowship in the Bible Clerk Shop, 1503. Hugh Pemberton, Alderman of London, who founded a fellowship, 1504. William Taylard of Diddington Hunts, Esquire, MP, JP, who gave £100, 1505. Robert Simpson, who founded a fellowship, 1506. Catherine Miles, who gave a house next to the Bull Inn, 1509. Lady Elizabeth Barnardston, widow who founded the first scholarship, 1514. John and Joan Marlborne, who founded the John Chester Fellowship, 1515. And Thomas Green, master, who paid for a range of chambers, 1517. During the next 150 years, the college received many further gifts, in some cases from donors, who arranged on opposite sides in the parties which then divided church and state. John Duke, who gave the rectories of Trunch and Gimmingham, and also his books and manuscripts, 1592. Edmund Hound, master, who bequeathed £100, 1598. Rosamond Payne, who founded two scholarships, 1610. Sir John Claypole, who provided for new buildings, the rents whereof supported two scholarships, 1613. John Gostlin, master of Gonville and Caius College, who gave the Bull Inn in Trumpington Street, 1626. Peter Pheasant, barrister of Gray's Inn, who gave money for buildings, 1630. Lady Anne Cockett, widow who founded scholarships, 1630. Thomas Hobbs, barrister of Gray's Inn, who made provision for two or three honest, hopeful, poor scholars, here and in Emmanuel College, 1631. Lady Catherine Barnardiston, who founded three scholarships, 1633. Alexander Stafford, remembrance of the Court of Wards, who gave £200 towards building the old E staircase, 1634. And Juliana, his wife, who founded four scholarships for poor students, 1627. Richard Sibbs, master, who founded the Master's Sizership, 1635. William Spurstow, father of the master of that name, who founded a scholarship, 1646. Robert Skern, who gave lands of Adlingfleet to found four scholarships, 1661. John Cartwright, who provided for two or three poor scholars, 1674, and Samuel Frankland, who endowed a bi-fellowship and a scholarship, 1691. In 1650, the master and all the fellows were ejected by Parliament for refusing to renounce the royalist cause. John Lightfoot was appointed master and held office for 25 years, skillfully steering the college through the troubled years of Commonwealth and Restoration. As it expanded in numbers and reputation, the college found its old buildings inadequate. They were replaced by others which still form the main court. Among the benefactors who helped to pay for them were John Eachard, Master and twice Vice-Chancellor, Sir John Rouse of Henham in Suffolk, the Duke of Somerset, Chancellor of the University, John Owen of Southgate, William Spence, Lord Cutts of Childerley, Lady Williamson of Hales in Norfolk, Madame Maresco, Sir Thomas Barnardiston, William Stanley, Master of Corpus Christi College, Sir Isaac Newton, Professor of Mathematics, John Pern, the Lord Jeffreys of Wem, Lord High Chancellor, and Matthew Scrivener, Vicar of Haslingfield, who bequeathed money and lands to provide for this chapel, 1688. These gifts did not meet the full cost of completing the new buildings, and at the beginning of the 18th century, work stopped for lack of funds. The college was, however, firmly established and of high reputation. It was strengthened and enlarged by the liberal support of many benefactors, among whom were Moses Holwy, who endowed a fellowship and two scholarships, 1695, John Addenbrooke, Doctor of Medicine and founder of the principal hospital in this city, who lies interred in the antechapel and who gave books and a cabinet, 1719. Lady Moyer, who gave for the aid of poor scholars that study God's word and live sober and honest lives, 1725. Mary Ramsden, great niece of an earlier benefactor, by whose liberality six fellowships were founded, together with 10 scholarships and A and B staircases were built, 1743. And Thomas Sherlock, Master and later Bishop of London, who gave his library and many other gifts, founded the library keepership and augmented the master's sizarship, 1761. In the second part of the 18th century, there was little public regard for the universities, and benefactions ceased for nearly a century. They began again with gifts from masters and fellows, chiefly Charles Burrell, Fellow, 1824, Joseph Proctor, Master, 1847, Edmund York, who died in 1873, having been a Fellow for 53 years, and out of whose legacy the college playing fields were purchased, and Thomas Jarrett, Doctor of Divinity, who founded a scholarship in Oriental languages, 1887. New support was needed to enable the college to face the challenges and opportunities which came at the beginning of the last century and continue today. In particular, we give thanks for Agnes Johns, who bequeathed money to provide for scholarships and exhibitions and for the Johns Building in memory of her husband, Charles Johns, Master. Thomas Drury, Master, formerly Bishop of Ripon. Sir John Withers, Fellow, Emily Posner, Kate Wilson, the parents of Roy Tasker, Mrs. C. M. Foreman, the friends of Daniel Owen Morgan, and the family of Henry Chaytor, Master, who gave his library to the college, Christopher Wadhams, Fellow and Chaplain, Robert Armitage, Donald Portway, Master, Edwin Rich, Master, Alex Jacobson, whose bequest supports the study of international law and the adornment of the college buildings, Sir Frank Bower, Alfred Clifford, Muriel Silk, whose bequest supports the work of the chaplain and the music in this chapel, Edward Francis, Harold Ridgen, fellow commoner who helped endow fellowships and buildings, Violet and Ian Campbell, who endowed a research fellowship, Winifred Howarth, who endowed a research fellowship and provided benefaction for the general purposes of the college, Donald Kellaway, fellow whose bequest supports the music in the college and chapel, and the following all of whose benefactions were for the general purposes of the college. Henry Tyler, Alexander Smith, Robert Hardy, Sidney Smith, Fellow, and his sister Kate, Thomas Soshen, Peter Ayscough, John Atkins, Eric Kemp, Charles Armour, T.F. Bauman, Edward Walter, Geoffrey Young, George Hellings, Canon Lawrence and Enid Tanner, Morris and Natalie Benovich, Graham Rushton, Owen Stinchcombe, Herbert and Sonia Gross, Stuart Cousins, Beville Mabey, fellow commoner, Louis Levy, Audrey Taylor, Robert Quan, Eric Hutchison, Norman Elgood, Gervaise Kearney, Robert Evans, Elizabeth Evans, John Balding, Peter Young, fellow commoner, Richard Fellingham, Tom Ivory, Alan Garraway, John Shakeshaft, fellow, Jeremy Bunting, Roy Chapman, fellow commoner, John and Pierrette Bergen, John Newton, Ben Bibby, fellow commoner, Peter Boiseau, fellow commoner, and Alan Battersby, honorary fellow. We also acknowledge the many corporate bodies by whose generosity the cause of learning and research has been furthered. Not least among its benefactors does the college count those who laid down their lives during two world wars, whose names are recorded upon the panels of this chapel, and all who have subscribed or contributed by their work and skill to the recent enlargements of the college buildings. These and others of many generations and over five centuries whose names have not been remembered through the accidents of time, we commemorate today.
For all that these gifts have meant in the enriching of the life of the college,
we honour the donors and give thanks to Almighty God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We offer our thanks and praise for the gifts of the past and the generosity of our many benefactors who have enabled the flourishing of this community through the centuries and which still continues today. We give thanks for scholarship, learning, research and study, for the chance to create memories and make lifelong friends, for an environment that encourages us to expand our minds and open our hearts to things we never imagined, for the beauty with which we are surrounded and the people whose dedication supports the St Catharine's community in so many ways. We ask your blessing today on this college and all its members, and pray that our experiences here may shape us to be a blessing to the world. We gather our prayers in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We pray together the College Collect. O everlasting God, with whom a thousand years are but as one day, and in whose name are treasured here the memorials of many generations, grant to us, whom thou hast made members of this college, such measures of grace and wisdom, that we may neglect no portion of our manifold inheritance, but may guard and use it to thy glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Render to no one evil for evil, but hold fast to all that is good. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Uphold the weak. Honour all people. Love and serve the Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen. Amen.